Welcome, friends. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to come and join us as we study God's Word through Mission on Fire's ministry. Today, our subject of study is the true service from heaven. We're going to study and learn what the Bible says about God's services in heaven and how that's applicable to our life and the earthly sanctuary. So I invite you to have your Bibles handy with you, and let's study together. But before we start, I invite you, let's open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray and ask for your guidance as we study your services and how that applies to each one of us. Father, we ask for your wisdom, for your truth. We pray that you will open our eyes and our ears so we may see and hear truth. And this truth would help us to develop the character that you've called us to have. We lift this time and this everybody's so that they may hear and receive and understand this truth. We lift this prayer in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen. So again, our subject of study today is the true service from heaven. You know, if we look at the Old Testament, we see that God placed a service of animal sacrifices that revolves around the priesthood. And in the priesthood, especially starting with Aaron and to the Levitical priest, there is services that is required of them to ensure that the sins of the people are rectified in a way through the blood of a goat, a lamb, a clean animal, so that sins can be forgiven or the remission of sins can be taken care of. And you know, all of this pointed to, guess who? Jesus Christ our Lord. So this earthly services is a replica or is a copy of the heavenly service. But you know, before we get going further, let me use an illustration to kind of lay the foundation before we get going. In the 1970s, there was an experiment that took place. Matter of fact, it was a prison experiment. So a professor was trying to learn what impacted the human psyche and the garments or the uniforms that one would wear, how that would change or affect the way people thought and act and live. So in this experiment, he asked for multiple clients to come in. He'll pay them and randomly select them into two groups. One group is prisoners who will have to wear a prisoner uniform. And then the other group is selected to be the guards, the prisoner guards, who will also wear a guard uniform with the baton and also sunglasses. So what started out as an experiment, as he learned through this experiment, is that within a couple short days, all the individuals that took on this role, it wasn't just role-playing, it really became life to them. In other words, they really took on the role, and it really became so real to them that it caused such a stir, to the point that there was a riot within that first week, and it really put the whole experiment to, it really ended the experiment. But you know, the takeaway from this experiment, this experience is that people, and there's a old saying, you are what you eat. In this case, it's more, you are what you wear. People took on the role so serious, even though that wasn't the intent, that it became so real to them that the guards were abusing the prisoners, and the prisoners were up in arms and were disgusted, and they rioted, and everybody just played this role naturally. So this lays a foundation, because it also points to a piece of who we are as a Christian. Now, as a Christian, we are what we wear. That's what we are going to dig into. Because, You know what the Word of God says? In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, it says, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, His own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light." You know, what this verse says is that we are chosen. We are a generation that God has selected, has called out. But who are we to be? A royal priesthood. That means that we ought to play the role of the priest. And what does a priest do? Well, the priest in the biblical narrative is one who serves in the sanctuary. Ah, there is a key. So do we serve in the earthly sanctuary? It's been destroyed in our day and age. Right. But we ought to be priesthoods to the spiritual temple. And the work that we do has to glorify God. You see, all of the sanctuary work, the sacrifice of the lamb, pointed to Jesus Christ. So we have to work the works that He's called us to be. We are also a special people, meaning God has called us to do very special things, to be unique, to be peculiar. We, as a priest, you know, there's certain things that a priest can do that others can't do. For example, the high priest can only go into the most holy place once a year. And even at that point, he has very specific parameters that God has called him to do, to serve the people, the Israelites. So that is the role of the priest. But you know what Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 and 16 says? Let's read that. It says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confessions. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." You know, a lot of times we see that verse and we skip all of the component of Jesus Christ, the high priest. And sometimes I'm not even sure if we understand what that means. You know what that means? It's such a blessing for us as Christians. Because Aaron and the Levitical priesthood, even though that was sufficient for the time, is not sufficient for eternity. We needed a great high priest, the ultimate high priest, the one whose priestlyhood is eternal, is without end. And that, brothers and sisters, is our Lord Jesus Christ. He came and filled that role, and He is now interceding on our behalf. You know, that's exactly what a priest does, is they intercede on behalf of the people with God. And they intercede for the sins of the people. And Jesus is doing exactly that. And we're so grateful that He does that. We're so grateful that He, after He died on the cross, paid the price of all of our sins. He didn't just kick His feet up and said, "The job is done." Even though He did say, "It is finished," in John 19:30. That is to signify, to call out that the sacrificial payment for the sins of the people is paid off, it's done. But the work is not yet. Because as we just read, and we will continue to read in Hebrews 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10, is that it talks about Jesus Christ taking on the high priest. And He is in this role, preparing and interceding for you and for I. Because also, what the high priest does, and I mentioned already, once a year, the Day of Atonement, is the sanctuary has to be cleansed. And the time for the sanctuary, the earthly sanctuary, to be cleansed is not far from now. It's yet to come. But we need to allow ourselves, purify ourselves through the blood of Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit working in us, changing our character so that it reflects Jesus Christ each day. That is how we can be a holy priesthood and start living the life that He has called us to be. In Hebrews 5:1, verse 6 and 9 and 10, excuse me. For every high priest taken from among men is appointed for men in things pertaining to God, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sin. So also Christ did not glorify himself to become high priest, but it was he who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he also says in another place, "You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek." Excuse me. "And have been perfected. He became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him, called by God as high priest according to the order of Melchizedek." You see, Jesus Christ took on that role because he is God. He is God incarnate and is the only one that is appropriate to play this role. Because all the Levitical priests up to that point, even though they sacrificed on behalf of the people, their lineage ended at the death of each one of them. But unlike them, Jesus is eternal. He takes this high priestly hood, and he is the ultimate, is the ongoing high priest. But you know, one thing as highlighted here, as it calls for the high priest or the priestlyhood, is that it is to do the things pertaining to God. So what are the things that pertains to God? Living a faithful, righteous life, interceding on behalf of the people, eating a particular way, living a particular way. As they take on the high priestlyhood, there is the priestly garments that needed to be wear, that is designed by God to make a distinction between the high priest and the Israelites. And so many more, but this is what signifies or separates the high priest from the people. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11, it says, "But Christ came as high priest of the good things to come, with the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is not of this creation, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood. He entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption." This Bible verse is so powerful because what it tells us is that Jesus need only to sacrifice himself one time, and his blood, because of who he is, his sacrifice was sufficient for all times. Therefore, that's why he says, "It is finished." Therefore, the earthly priesthood and all the sacrificial system ended that day because that is no longer needed. Remember, all that pointed to Jesus, and when Jesus fulfilled it, it is done. And like he said, it is finished. There is no more. So he is our eternal high priest. But the question we should ask is, what right did Jesus have to take this priesthood? How did he come about this? You know, it's God has his plans. But if we look back to the Old Testament, we can see that God designed the priesthood with very distinct roles, as mentioned, and very distinct garments. In Exodus chapter 28, verse 15, it says, "You shall make the breastplate of judgment, artistically woven according to the workmanship of the ephod. You shall make it of gold, of blue, purple, scarlet thread, and fine woven linen. You shall make it." This priesthood, this garment, is defined by a very specific color: gold, blue, purple, and scarlet thread. It is done in a very precise manner. God ordained the priesthood from heaven. Remember, the earthly sanctuary is a copy of the heavenly sanctuary. So that's where the true heavenly service is from. You know, in Exodus 28, as we read on in verse 31, it says, "You shall make the robe of ephod all blue. There shall be an opening for his head in the middle of it. It shall have a woven binding all around its opening, like the opening of a coat of mail, so that it does not tear." Keep that in mind, so that it does not tear. We'll come back to that. "And upon its hem you shall make pomegranates of blue, purple, and scarlet. all around his hand with the bells of gold between them all. You know, in Revelations chapter 17 and 19, it also talks about a false priesthood. Did you know that? It talks about this woman who garbs herself and is called Mystery Babylon. And she has the priestly garments. She wears the color gold, red or scarlet, purple. But you know what color she's missing? Blue. It's important for us to know the distinction here, that God's priestlyhood is of four critical colors. Again, gold, blue, purple, and scarlet, or red. The counterfeit, or the false priestlyhood, is gold, scarlet, and purple. It doesn't have the blue. I invite you to open up or look at our previous study where we study about the blue laws or true blue, where it talks about the distinction between the blue and why one has the blue and the other doesn't. But this is important because as we look at the garments here, it is God specified that the ephod should be made of all blue. Keep that in mind. The inner clothing, the robe itself, shall be all blue. Again, there goes the distinction. And the blue, really, in essence, represents God's character and God's law. That is the distinction. God's law is with the priesthood that he established versus the false priesthood found in Revelation. They don't have God's law. They are a replica that is lawlessness, that does not have God's character, God's law. And that is the distinction. But again, notice that it says that this garment shall not tear. So let's read on and let's study more to see why did God specify it should not tear. And we'll find out that it happened contrary. In Leviticus chapter 10, verse 6, it says, "And Moses said to Aaron and to Eleazar and Itamar, his sons, do not uncover your heads nor tear your clothes, lest you die and wrath come upon all people." Let me add another verse. In Leviticus 21, verse 10, "He who is high priest among his brethren, on whose head the anointing oil was poured, and who is consecrated to wear the garments, shall not uncover his head nor tear his clothes." So we see two verses supporting the same thing, which is as part of the priestly garment, we need to take care of the garment so that it would not tear. It was, matter of fact, it's designed in such a way that it is a one-piece garment, not sewn and not designed to tear. God has a purpose. You know why? Because as we look and as we dig more, we'll study and see in John chapter 19, verse 23, what happened here. Let's read. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts to each soldier apart, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam. So here is the representation of the ephod, woven from the top in one piece. They said, therefore, among themselves, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing cast lots." Therefore, the soldiers did these things. You know what's significant about this little detail that we probably read over and over and missed this point? Is that Jesus, again, right before he officially took on the high priesthood, his garment, his tunic, is not torn. But you will see as we read further and we'll uncover whose garment was torn and how that affected the priesthood. But in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, verse 13 and 14 says, "After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number, of all the nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands. Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, 'Who are these arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from?' So he said to me, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. You see, the robe signifies so many things. But in Revelation chapter 7 here, it talks about God's people having the white robe, which is the character of Jesus Christ. We have the righteousness of Jesus Christ, and we put on Jesus. That is the distinction. But let's go back from the change. Where did the earthly priesthood change into Jesus Christ's priesthood? Here is where we, if we uncover this detail, it makes all the difference. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 62 through verse 66, let's read that. It says, and the high priest arose and said to him, do you answer in nothing? What is these men testifying against you? But Jesus kept silent. And the high priest answered and said to him, I put you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said to him, it is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man, standing in the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Then, here's the detail that I want us to capture. Then the high priest tore his clothes, saying, he has spoken blasphemy. What further need do we have of witnesses? Look now, you have heard his blasphemy. What do you think? They answered and said, he is deserving of death. You see that little detail? The priesthood, the high priest, Caiaphas, as the Pharisees and the Sadducees were trying to get Jesus or get false testimonies to allow Jesus to be killed, to be crucified. That was their intent. And when Jesus claimed himself to be God, the high priest tore his clothes. In his thought, in complete destruction of his disagreement to what Jesus said, but what he didn't know and what God planned ahead of time was that as this high priest who tore his earthly robe, he also tore and destroyed the priesthood from a man's perspective. In other words, at that point where the robe, the ephod, that the priest was wearing, as it was torn, it signified the change from the earthly priesthood to Jesus. We also get this, and it's more common, when we read in Matthew chapter 27, verse 50 through 51. This is when Jesus was being crucified, and at his death, what happened? The veil was torn. Let's read together. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then, behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split. Again, this also signified these two are connected. These are connected points. The priesthood, as the clothes was torn, signified the changeover from the earthly priesthood to Jesus Christ. The veil being torn, meaning that we can come to Jesus, our high priest, and we can come directly and boldly before the throne of God. And there's no more need of daily sacrifices. So Jesus took on that role because it was taken away from man and given unto Jesus. In Hebrews chapter 7, verse 16 and 22 through 27, it says, who has come not according to the law of fleshly commandment, but according to the power of an endless life. By so much more, Jesus has become a surety of a better covenant. Also, there were many priests because they were prevented by death from continuing. But he, because he continues forever, has an unchangeable priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For such a high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens, who does not need daily as much as those high priests to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For he did this once and for all when he offered up himself. Jesus, the ultimate high priest, that's what everything pointed to. And he took on the role because it was his to own. And unlike the other earthly priests who had to sacrifice for their own sins, Jesus was blameless. He was holy. He was righteous. He was the perfect Lamb of God, the one that took on this role. And Jesus took it, and it became his permanently, and it is his now permanently. That's why we can always pray and ask in the name of Jesus through his own blood that shed on the cross some 2,000 years ago, because he is our sacrificial lamb that paid all of our sins, and he now is interceding on our behalf. What a glorious God. What a powerful act of love that Jesus displayed for all of us. Isn't our God good? Isn't our Lord Jesus so selfless, so loving? And he did this and continues to do this role because he wants us to be reconciled unto him. And so that our sins can be no more. Our sins can be forgiven so that we can stand before the throne of God righteous as he is righteous, not because of what we've done, but because of what he did at the cross. In Isaiah 61, verse 10 says, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. Amen. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorns herself with jewels. I think that's pretty straightforward, where we put on this garment because we have salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ. And that robe of righteousness, we put on Jesus Christ. We live out the character of Jesus Christ. But the key piece I like to capture here is he decks himself with ornaments. The bridegroom, Jesus, in the Hebrew word, it really means he does the services of the priest. That's what that sentence means. So Jesus does the works of the high priest. Now right below that, it says, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. This also means, in relation to that first sentence, that the bride, us, the church, also acts as high priest, just like Jesus is high priest. Isn't that powerful? So it ties back to our verse, which says, we are a royal priesthood. We are a chosen generation that God has hand-selected us to be priesthood, to be representatives of him to this earth. Ellen White wrote, the white raiment is purity of character, the righteousness of Christ imparted to the sinner. This is indeed a garment of heavenly texture that can be bought only of Christ for a life of willing obedience. So as priesthoods, or as people who is now chosen to take on that priestlyhood, we need to live a life of willing obedience, to do his work, to sacrifice, to live a righteous life, just like the high priest is, because we have one who intercedes on our behalf. But as physical counterparts to Jesus Christ, we need to intercede or bring people to Christ, teach them the good news, and have them go to Jesus Christ, who is our true intercessor, who is the one that can open the gates to God in heaven and can be the middleman between a sinful people or persons and our God. Isn't it powerful that we have such a great high priest, Jesus Christ, who continually does his work for you and for me so that we can continually be cleansed, so that the world can hear this gospel of truth, be cleansed, and know that this service in heaven is continually happening and occurring. But brothers and sisters and friends, this role, this intercessory role that Jesus is playing, or this task that he is doing on our behalf, has an end. It will come to an end on the Day of Atonement. Just like the earthly priesthood, there is a Day of Atonement to cleanse the sanctuary, because the sanctuary represents God's throne, who he is. But all that sin has to go somewhere. God's sanctuary would need to be cleansed. And at the point of the cleansing of the sanctuary, you and I have to be righteous. You and I have to be perfected by the blood of Jesus Christ and be pure. And at that point, he will come back and take us back into heaven. But until then, you and I have a role to play. We are his priesthood. We are a chosen generation. We should live like one in righteous, holy character, just as Jesus Christ has lived and has laid the perfect example for you and for I. I hope this lesson was a blessing, that we learned a lot, and come back and join with us as we study God's word next time. Let's end with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, for your grace, for your truth, for your heavenly services that is taking place today. Because we've got a glimpse of it in the earthly services. And God, we are so grateful that we are called and chosen, and we are your priesthood to intercede or to connect with the people and to bring them to Jesus, who is our high priest, who is the one that stands between a holy God and a sinful people or a sinful nation. We thank you for your work that cleanses us. We pray that we will live in accordance to your will and live the life that glorifies you. We lift this prayer in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for joining us. Hope you'll come back next time.